Good afternoon. My name is Alex Schneider. I'm a field application engineer at Wood Electronic, and I welcome you today to our first joint session between Texas Instruments and Wood Electronic. Our topic of today will be USB-C, and we're going to talk about a variety of things. But before I tell you more about the webinar and the people who will be presenting, first a few things to consider. During the sessions, you are muted, but you can still ask questions. On the right side of your screen, you will find a screen called questions or answers or something different if your language settings are different than English. There you can write down all the questions that that you have during the presentation. And at the end of the session, we will try to get back to all those questions. Of course, it could happen that we have too many questions or that your question is too specific. In that case, we will get back to you by phone or by email in order to answer your questions after the sessions. But in all cases, your questions, of course, will be answered. We're also recording this session in order to post it on our YouTube channel where you can review it. So that's always helpful if you have some questions afterwards or want to review the material again for whatever reasons. So this is you're able to find it over there. Like I said, the sessions of today will be handled by my colleagues posted over here. So Remco van der Grient from Wood Electronic will kick off the meeting. We'll talk mainly about the USB connector, the RF performance of that connector, and also some PCB considerations. Nijiu from, I cannot pronounce the last name, sorry, Nijiu, will talk about mainly, of course, the IC topologies, the different things you can choose there, about PD drive or not, power levels, all that kind of things. Also signal integrity and some application examples will go by. And myself will finish the session. I will focus a little bit more on the EMI, also signal integrity, and also some interference we could have with our RF products like Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. And how we could prevent that by applying the right combo chokes there. And also want to take advantage of this moment to advertise for our next session, which is planned in 2 weeks' time, same location, same time, only different date. And this will go over single pair Ethernet. I think everyone who has some kind of fixed connection, is it Ethernet or Canvas or whatever, could be interested in this subject as well. So. Please use the shortcut I put here to register if you haven't done so already. So that is it for this part. I really urge you to ask any questions you might have. Again, you can use the Q&A sessions for that. And for now, I will hand over to Remco van der Grient to start off his presentation.
Many thanks, Alex, for your introduction, for your brief introduction. What already Alex explained from his side, that I am a field application engineer for Wood Electronic now for almost 3 years. I mainly have the focus on electrical mechanical parts of Wood Electronic, so also the USB connector. That's why I'm starting with this presentation, because we want to start with the USB connector. Before we really start off this topic, this is the agenda for my part of this session with a joint webinar with Wood Electronic and TI. First, a little bit the history of USB, the electrical and mechanical performance of the USB, the USB connector itself, and the processability, because of the raising of the high speed of all the signals for USB, it becomes more and more important to make a good solderability on your PCB with this connector. So that's why I also want to take this within consideration with you. I want to let you see some hints and tricks on that way. So as discussed, first a little bit the small history of USB. And I'm starting already with USB 2.0. And not with 1.1, because that's, of course, that was 1.0 and 1.1, of course, was the first introduction. But in 2000, the USB 2.0 was Yeah, really an important part of the introduction of this protocol. You see here a lot of different sort of connectors, like the A, B, the mini and micro versions. Of course, there was not a C version like we have now. Of course, you can see the data rate. I think a lot of people already knows this 480 megabit per second with a power of 500 milliamps and 5 volts, so 2.5 watts. And then you see really the difference between every protocol on this way. So also the mini connector was taken out of the protocol. So there will be no USB mini connector for the USB 3.0 introduction. So only the micro B, and still if you look to that, it was really a big one still if you look into that. If you look into this one, you see really it's a particular big one if you look into the other micros. Of course, the data rate already make a big step to 5,000 megabit per second. The power is up to 4.5 watts. And then USB 3.1 came. At this point also, at this moment, it is a little bit changing from his name. It's now USB 3.2 Gen 2 is also called on that way. Still, you see A, B, micro, but also the C is added. C is not a special protocol. It's only a connector that is also introduced together with the USB 3.1. At that point, the data rate is 10 gigabit per second. So at this moment already, we have 20 gigabit per second. And with the power delivery protocol, where also Nijiu is going to talk about later on, it's going up to 100 watts. So it's really a big step if you can see from 2000 till where we are now. So that's a little bit a brief introduction of USB. But with this evaluation of evolution of this connector, you see also that a lot of other things are really change a lot in the connector world, and we need to really consider a lot of things, especially also electrical wise, but also then we must look to the mechanical part of the connector. So also the shielding must be really okay because of the high speed signals we must transport. Also the shielding must be okay. So that a lot of things must be considered when this was introduced on that way with the C connector. But looking to the difference in into the A, B, micro, B, and the C versions, you see that we have a lot of different sort of things. The power pins for the A, B, and micro B are almost the same, only with micro B you have power pins at 1 and 5, because with micro B you have also an on-the-go pin, so that there, because then you have 5 pins on that way. With C, with the USB-C connector, you have power pins for the A1, A4, B9, A12. I think everybody can read also for the B versions. It's the same, the B row. Later on, you can see a little bit more in depth how everything is built up in the USB-C connector. And also the A5 and B5 you can consider as a power pin. So you see here the voltage is standard 5 volt. If you go into the power delivery protocol, then you can go up to 20 volts. So that's why it's standard here is 20 volt, but the C also can it can handle a rated voltage of 20 volt on that way. This is electrical wise. Also the insulation resistance is pretty high for a small connector if you look into the C connectors. But also the smaller one, so it's everything is really specified in USB IF specification, so you really can find that everything if you want to look there. Also mechanical wise, there are a little bit changes when new connectors are coming up on that way. You see here for the A and B, you have a mating cycles, and they must be tested with this speed of 200 cycles per hour. That mating cycles are 1,500 or 5,000 mating cycles, and that's depending for which protocol. For USB 2.0, you have 1,500, and for USB 3.0, you have 5K mating cycles. for micro B and C, you have already 10,000 making cycles. So that you see already there also a big gap between them. Again, with that speed, it must be tested on that way. Otherwise, it doesn't can consider it as a real USB connector if it's not tested on that way, as we as a manufacturer. The insertion force, you see also here that it's specified in the USB IF specification. You see that it looks like the USB-C has a lower insertion force, but it's a smaller one, a smaller connector. So that's really, really good to handle that. It's really in a good way that it's really close, that you have really good contact pressure to that, that it's really can transport the RF signals from A to B in a good way. Also, again, with an specified speed from 12.5 millimeters per minute. Also the extraction force, so the retention, if it also called, that you need to extract the plug and the receptacle from each other. With mating cycles, again mentioned, before mating cycles, before you're going to use, after 1K cycles, that's introduced with the USB-C connector. You can see here that is a little bit different already. And at the max of the mating cycles, that is also specified how many extraction force you need. So you see that we as a manufacturer must check a lot of things before we can put it on the market, that everything is going smoothly, and we must use the standards of the USB IF one. As already told, we're going to let you see more about the pin configuration of the USB receptacle on this way. You see a double row version, and that's of course really, really an advantage of the USB-C connector, because it's reversible. So it's really have, that's why you have double rows and an A row and a B row. And of course they are really crossed on that way. So the A1 is left on the left top, and the B1 is on the right bottom. So, and you see here still there are a lot of already used pins or namings that's already used in USB 3.1 protocol. Like you see here, the TX and plus and TX, TX1 minus and RX2 minus and RX2 plus already from the USB 3.0 protocols. And of course you see here the USB 2.0 data pairs. But there are also a little bit more added another pins, like the VBUS, that's also there, but that has a little bit more changed of the way they are used. You have to, a really new pin is a CC1, and that's a configuration channel. And Nietzsche also going to introduce a little bit more about how that's going to be used for, especially also for the power delivery mode and that sort of things, also for the alternative modes. Like I said, the USB 2.0 data pairs, SBU, is especially for sideband use. For the alternative modes like DisplayPort, HDMI, audio, and that sort of things, they also can be transported over the USB Type-C receptacles and plugs. So that's really a really good thing also about this USB-C connector. But again, Neju will tell you more about it later on. Then you have got also the plug. And at this moment, you have two different sort of plugs in the world. One with 22 pins, like you see here. And like you see on the next slide, the 24 pins you see here at the B6 and B7, that you have an extra pair of USB 2.0 data pairs. Till a couple of years ago, there were not really multiplexers for the USB 2.0 signals. That's why only you could imagine that we only have at one side of the plug the data pairs for USB 2.0 and not on the other side, because that is also for the orientation of the cable of the plug itself. That's why we have double sort. Now we're going to check a little bit more about layouting, because that's what I already told, it's really important that layouts are really going to match a lot of good things and how to to handle a lot of things. Like you see here, we have an USB 3.1 C EMC dongle that you can also order at our site with to check if everything is okay on EMC wise, and also for the power delivery filtering, as you see again on the bottom side. And we can have a look more on a couple of things because it's a high dense connector. Sorry, it's a high dense connector, so it's hard to make a good layouting and routing of for your PCB. And we received a lot of questions about if I want to place vias inside of our tracer because I can't do it on another way. Is that possible, or how many vias can I place in one differential pair or something like that? For us as manufacturers, it's hard to tell because we have a lot of side effects like solder resist and that sort of things, but also the tolerances of drilling that can affect your signal. So that's really hard to tell for us and inform you about how many vias you can use or where you must place them. But you have some the thumb rules about that. You see, they are saying between 2 and 3 vias. It could be that it's on the edge that you can use in one differential pair on that way. So you see here also some via placed in between the differential pair. It's especially the differential pair of USB 2.0. For this one, it's not a problem because USB 2.0 can handle a little bit more higher losses than the special differential pair for the 3.x transmission and receiving differential pair. So that's a little bit less problems. So that could be an option, of course. Of course, you have different sort of vias on the market. Of course, you have a plated through hole version, a blind via, or buried vias on the market. And I want to let you see a little bit more on the different way. Here you can see cross section of the PCB, and you have here a fully plated through hole. You see here a buried via, and you see here a blind vias on that way. Blind vias is going from the top of an and you can still see them from the top or the bottom of the PCB. Then you have a blind via, and they are filled in with epoxy and that sort of things. And you see here also the buried via, and the buried via is that you can't see them from the top. They are already in the laminating of the PCB itself, and you can't see them. And of course, the plated through hole, you really can't see them. But really, it's really hard to do, and why you have different sort of choices, because especially with the high speed signals, and you must solder the via at the in the whole way, and you only have especially with vias where you're going from one layer to the other one, and you have a fully length of your via, and you're only going from this path to that path, and this one is still open, then this part of the via can be used as an antenna on EMI problems. So it really can interfere on your signal. So you really can have problems with transporting of the signal on a good way. So you want to avoid it, and that's why you can use a blind vias or buried vias. But sometimes this is too expensive. Then you also can use back drilled or control depth drilling. As you can see here, the signal path again, you want to avoid that this via is used as an as an antenna. So with the back drilling, it will be that the drill will come from the bottom side. They drill open with a bigger drill than the via is. They drilling away all the copper here, and then you see it like this, and you still have a good path for your signal on that way. For your information, the fabrication cost for blind vias to normal vias is around plus 25%. For buried vias is between 25 and 60%, depending on how big the vias are and that sort of things. And for back drilling, it's around 10% higher cost than normal vias. So you also can control your cost on that way with back drilling. Magnetics, I will go, because of the time, I will put this to Alex. Normally, the common mode chokes must be more on the transmission side, and the ESD suppressors must be on the receiving side. Why that's, I think everybody knows, and also Alex comes back later on. Then there's later a little bit more about processability. It's about the PCB layout. You see here, and also a footprint. You see it's really a combination of SMT pins and THR pins, and it's not really not easy to use it on that way. You see here the stencil and the for paste printing. You see on the top side, you see that everything is filled on, really with the right calculation of the volume. And with the bottom view, you see that we still have rings with a quarter filled on that way, but really on the surface, as to make here at the bottom side that there's really a lot of enough volume of pin paste on that tin paste on that way, so it's really okay to have the right volume of paste that everything is filled with 100%, because especially with higher speed signals, you don't want to. You want to avoid that that the VR, for instance, is filled only with 75% or something like that, because that can influence also your signal. So you want to be sure that a lot of that enough paste will be and thin are in your fully played a true hole in that way. So that's why it's better to use this part and this between the difference between this is this is mostly used with especially with squeezing of your paste, this one especially with paste printing with a paste jet or something like that, to that that you really can make a secure deposit on your paste. And how that will that seen in really in a way how it really going to work. This one is soldering without defects. It's really see that everything is filled up on a good way. Here you see that you see have some defects, and that's not a really defect, but you have less volume of paste there, so less of solder tin. And you really can see here that it's not every time the meniscus on a good way, so there you have less paste in it and less tin soldered. So there could be that transmission from RF signals from A to B are not okay, and this is with hand soldering. We made also an X-ray of it on that way, and this one is really special. What I did with the extra paste deposit is placed there, and you see here that no shadow is in there, so no problems with the THR pins, and also here. And also here you see with yeah, that's these are the SMT leads, and you really can see that everything is okay. That's my part of the one. So the conclusion from my side is the USB connector has really tight specifications to ensure the working on electrical and mechanical way. Placing and routing is really hard, and it's really different than the other connectors, but it's really it's ask you more to really look on the good way to the layouting of your PCB, but also on placing of your PCB, and soldering is really has really a big influence on the really high speed signals. So be aware that soldering of the connectors needs more attention than the other USB connectors on that way. So again, this is my part of the my presentation, so I will hand over now to Neju.
Thank you very much, Remco.
Thank you, Remco. That was a very nice presentation, and I definitely did learn a lot about the connector choice and how critical it is.
Okay,
thank you. Video on. I'm going to share my screen now. I think you should be able to see it right now. I'm going to go into full screen mode. Now, let me welcome everyone to this portion of the webinar, where we will talk about as an introduction to USB Type-C and PD. But before that, let me also introduce myself. My name is Vishwas Nidan Gunasekaran, complicated. So I go by the name Nidu, it's my nickname. And I work as an analog field applications engineer at Texas Instruments. And I'm based out of the Netherlands sales office. So for today, let me set the stage for this presentation. We all know about USB Type-C, as also Remco explained. But I mean, for example, we have smartphones, Android smartphones, which already come up with USB Type-C connectors. But when if you're an engineer and you're working on a new application, and if you start asking this question, do I need USB Type-C? Or can I just go with a legacy USB 2.0? Or if you have any questions related to, do I need a PD controller or do I need a CC controller? These kind of questions will be answered in this presentation. So we will start off with some basics and set the stage. And further on, we will go into a full-fledged USB PD kind of application. So let me also start off with the evolution of USB. So as Remco said, USB has been around for about 20 years, with starting with speeds of up to 1.5 megabits and going up to 10 gigabits in 2013. But in 2014, something cool happened. And not instead of just the 10 gigs data, USB-C also allowed another alternate mode where you can send, for example, DisplayPort at 8.1 gigs. And on top of that, to support the power-hungry applications, they also allowed 100 watt power in these connectors. And moving forward and looking a future ahead, in 2017, USB 3.02 was released with two exports of the 10 gigs and aggregated of 20 gigabits speeds. And in 2019, USB 4.0 even allowed up to 40 gigs of aggregated data. But for today's webinar, we will be mostly concentrating on USB-C. And to reiterate what Remco said, there are these various connectors. So instead of not only just with the USB data, but also video, power, everything is then compressed into one connector. So it's like one size for all. That brings in quite a lot of advantages when you look at from an application point of view. One of the biggest advantage, I said earlier, is higher data throughput. So you with USB Type-C, you can reach up to 40 gigs, but with legacy up to 10 gigs. And that said, USB type A or B only supports USB data, but USB type C also supports DisplayPort, Thunderbolt, and HDMI along with USB. And with the added advantage, if you have an application where you need voltages above 5 volts or 1.5 amps, then USB type C is the way to go. This is a very short answer. Let's look at some basics over here once again. USB 3.x already had backward compatibility to USB 2.0 signal. So you had this bi-directional interface with D plus and D minus, and you had for power V bus and ground. USB 3.x introduced super speed transmit and receive dual simplex differential path. And USB-C, in order to allow this flippable functionality, added an extra dedicated unidirectional differential pair. So you had one extra TX2 and RX for the receive side. Now, since you have these two extra transmit and receive signals, and in order to detect, there was this other configuration channel that was introduced. And this is actually one of the most important aspects. I will have another slide explaining exactly how this one is helping us. And SPU is mainly used for alternate modes. And this is, you must be very familiar over here with this whole receptacle. But let me quickly reiterate, we have four ground pins and four V-bus for the power. And you might think, why? The main reason is because of this complete small form factor, as Remco had mentioned. The height of this whole receptacle is only 3 millimeters. And due to this, and also because USB Type-C and PD offers up to 100 watt, in order to deliver this power, you have these 8X pins. Over here, let's skip this for the time being, and let's look at the USB 2.0 data. In the previous slide from Remco, you also saw that for plugs, you did not have D minus or D plus. So you can also basically connect these two, the D plus and the D minus on the PCB side, so that you don't, I mean, it's more like a stub, but you cannot do the same for this, the transmit signals, because of the high speed nature. Over here, a normal flippable receptacle, there are these two CC channels. The second channel normally takes the position of a VCON, so that it can power some active cables or some of the components that could go on this USB Type-C. And as said, SBU is short for sideband use, and it's not part of USB-C, but as for PD and only for alternate modes. Let's start asking questions about the different design considerations that you might need to ask. Do you need USB signals for your application, or do you need video and audio data? So if you need USB signals, is USB 2.0 already sufficient for you, or do you need USB 3? In case if USB 2 is sufficient, and if you need signal conditioning, you might need to consider using a USB 2 redriver. I will touch upon this at a later stage. And the same for USB 3, you need a USB 3 mux. And then if signal conditioning is needed, you would add another USB 3 redriver. For alternate mode, you need an additional alternate mode mux. And if signal conditioning is needed, again, you need an alternate mode redriver. So let's look at the power aspect of your application. If you have an application that requires less than 15 watt application, then a simple CC controller and a power switch should already suffice. But if your application needs more than 15 watt power, then a PD controller is required. And if you are using alternate mode for video data transfer, then again, you need PD controller, because alternate mode is only supported by USB-C PD. We talked about in the previous slide that we need a mux. Now, why is that? So in short, the receptacle, being a flippable in nature, requires a lot of connectors and pins. And in order to reduce the complexity of the pin count on the USB controller, you need a configuration switch or mux, which helps translate this flippable connector to a USB controller. Now, normally this USB switch is controlled by the CC or PD controller. And in case if you're using alternate mode, then you also need to use a SBU mux to support this. And USB 2.0 mux is optional because of the low speed data you could, and as I said earlier, you could stop them diagonally. Now let's zoom out of all of these applications and start talking about the different port configurations that are possible with USB. So USB basically had two modes, right? Host mode and device mode. Before we go here, let's take an example. Let's take a smartphone and a wall adapter charger. So in this case, the wall adapter charger will be the host, which means that it will provide power for this sync or device mode over here, hence called a downstream facing port. So the power goes downstream towards the sync. And then USB-C offers an extra mode called the dual role mode. As the name suggests, and as we took the previous example of a mobile phone, you could connect, and for example, a light or a fan, you know, these fancy fans that you just connect to your phone, you can take around with as an example. So then your phone turns into a dual role mode, and the extra fan that you put into your phone would be the sync. And also let's look at these configurations, you know, to explain this better. In a normal form, DSP is then going towards a USB. And over here, we took the example of the wall adapter, right? So wall adapter would be the host. And then the phone, which is in actually DRP mode or dual role mode, will be acting as a sync. But after your phone is charged and you connect the phone to a USB fan, then the phone switches its role as a host mode, and it supports the sync. then the next question comes up. What if I connect a phone to a laptop? This is a perfect example for DRP to DRP. So both the laptop and the phone function as a dual role port. And depending on the configuration, it could automatically or manually be driven as a source or a sync. In this slide, let me quickly show you the default condition for USB Type-C. So you have DSP and USB, so power and data are flowing from the source to sync, right? But then please be aware for PD offers another difference over here. You can source power to the sink and then the data can flow in the reverse direction, or you can take power from the sink and source data to the sink. This is allowed only for PD. So for this kind of configuration, you would probably need a PD controller. Talk about an example at the end of the presentation at full PD. So we talked a lot about, you know, these different roles. Now the question comes, how does this, you know, how does a PD controller know whether if it's a DSP or a USB? In order to do this, the key of the receptacle comes into play, or otherwise called as the CC pin, as I said earlier. So the main role of the CC pin is to detect a valid connection. And once a valid connection is set, it configures whether it is a DSP or a USB, and then establishes the required VBUS current. And apart from this, it also helps to resolve cable orientation and twist connections by configuring the configuration mux. And after all of this is done, it also allows discovery and configuration of other alternate modes. Now let's see how it works. You know, it all still sounds a little bit complicated, but it's actually negotiating power is very simple and robust. The source always offers what it can provide. And once the source says it, the sink sees, okay, I need XYZ of power. And then the source then accepts this and then does the handshake. But now comes the question, what if the sink needs more power? And let's take an example here. If you connect your phone to your laptop with the legacy USB port, for example, an S20 can have fast charging at up to 25 watts. But the legacy laptops, I don't think they can supply this. So what happens? The phone would say, hey, I need 25 watts to enable fast charging. But the laptop would deny and say, hey, I can only supply lower, maybe 15 watts or less. And in that case, the phone has to go out of fast charging mode and try to function with what it is capable of. And another application, and also to highlight why this is very important, is if you have an S21, which is capable of up to 45 watts fast charging, you have this special wall adapters which have dual ports. And if you, these dual ports in order to have less complex designs, and with a less complex flyback kind of topology, comes with dual ports. And each of these ports is then, the power rail splits into these two roles, these two ports, I'm sorry. So that means one port would have 22.5 watts and the second port would have 22.5. And when you connect your S21 to one of the ports, the S21 will say, hey, I need now 45 watts to enable fast charging. And in this application, the PD controller, there will be two PD controllers for these two different ports, right? They will communicate with each other and say, okay, port one needs 45 watts. So let me route all the power to the first port. And in order to do this, you know, such a statement of capability mismatch is actually needed. And all of these extra features is then done through this. Now let's look the whole startup sequence in detail. Once you connect, the CC, as we said, detects the valid connection. And once the valid connection is detected, the VBUS has 5 volts and 500 milliamps. And as you already realized over here, until this valid connection is detected, there is no voltage or current flowing on the VBUS. Hence, the USB Type-C kind of port is called a cold socket. Whereas the traditional USB A or B had 5 volt on the VBUS, hence called a hot socket. This is the primary difference, right? And after this 5 volt and 500 milliamps is provided, the PD contract is established. And after a PD is established, the negotiated power is delivered. And once the negotiated power is delivered, the different mode, if there is a check done to see, okay, is there an alternate mode or not? So if this is not a PD application, then you can skip this step. But after, if an alternate mode is initiated, then USB enumeration happens, and also on the CC channel, the various steps are done. If this particular instant, if a PD contract is not established, then you could theoretically have BC1.2, but this is not mandatory. So let's go ahead and understand over here. Let me show over here. We talked a lot about, you know, this detecting this valid connection. Now, how exactly does this happen? Normally, both on the source side, there is a pull-up resistor on both the CC pins, and the same is on the sink side. There are two, but over here there are two pull-down resistors. So once when there is a connection happening, there would be a change in the voltage, which is, I mean, imagine this as a resistive bridge. So once there's a connection, there is a change in the voltage, which is then detected by the USB PD or CC controller, thus establishing, okay, there is a connection happening. And you could as well skip or replace this pull-up resistor with the current source. But let's see in detail how this is all happening. In this particular page, I'm trying to show the whole flow of data. So over here you have a source with the receptacle, that's the source part. And this is a cable with two plugs. And you can see that there is a VCON for the plugs. And then this is the sink side. Let's see here. Over here, there are two resistor pull-ups on CC1 and CC2 pin. And there are two pull-downs on the CC1 and CC2 pins. So the PD controller immediately checks and sees, okay, there is a valid connection established from CC1 to CC and CC to the sink side CC1. Then the PD controller knows, and it will switch the mux in order in such a way that the data flows in this particular direction and goes all the way. And if you look at the second channel, there is once again here a pull-up resistor. And then if you see, it's then connected to a VCON to a RA. So if you're supplying super speed signals, then you have to supply 5 volts to the VCON. Now comes the question, why? Since USB Type-C offers up to 20 volts, and I mean, there are normally these active components on these boards, and you cannot supply these low voltage active components with 20 volts. So the complexity increases. In order to avoid that, USB recommends that the source provides 5 volts on the CC2 pin to provide to the VCON, which in turn will power the rest of the active components on the cable or on the board. Now let's see another example over here. So here, everything is the same, but then the cable is now turned, or it's flipped. In this case, the CC1 pin checks, okay, there is no connection over here, but on the CC2, there is a path that is flowing. So the PD controller will switch the mux on the source side to the next junction. And then the data flows through in the regular path and goes out to the sink. And I think this is done. Now let's look at some typical applications. Now here comes the interesting part, right? Here is a simple block diagram or a representation of a USB 2.0. So if you have this question, hey, I need to use only USB 2.0 in my application, but I want to use a USB Type-C, then all you need is a simple CC controller or PD controller, depending on the power requirements, and then a VBUS power switch to limit the current. the rest of the high-speed signals can be left open, and this is also optional. And on the sync side, you don't need this power switch. Instead, you only need the CC or PD controller to negotiate the power requirements. I would like to show something over here in terms of signal integrity. So if you look down over here, I'm showing you an eye diagram, as it's an important tool to determine what is the interference of a high speed signal, right? Over here, you can clearly see that the eye diagram does not pass. And then comes the question, but it's on USB 2.0 and it's not really high speed, only 480 megabits. But USB 2.0 has very strict compliance issues or requirements. And therefore, most of the time, if there is some issues with the layout or so on, or if the trace is too long, you might not pass this compliance, USB compliance. In order to do so, you could use a USB redriver, which then enhances this signal. So what happens is you could fix this USB 216, which is a redriver. It has some super cool features like ultra small size, but the key differential feature is that it has flow through PCB routing, which means you don't have to break this DP or DM trace. Instead, you can, on the bottom side of this IC, there is a path. So you could just solder this on top of the two roots, and then this will help clear the signal and enhance the signal and help you pass USB 2. And the biggest advantage is you don't have to place this on the board. While you're doing a schematic and layout, you could just put the layout on this and then make it as do not place. And only if you don't pass USB 2, then you can put it on. And as far as I understand, TI is the only company that offers this. And let's move to the USB-C. So in case over here, if you want to use USB-C or PD port, as we discussed earlier, you only have to add a configuration mux to the traditional USB 2 that we saw in the previous, the second slide. The USB host controller, once again, offers the D plus D minus and also the super speed transmit and receive channels. The mux is then controlled by the PD or CC controller, and then the exact path is then defined in terms of how the connection is happening. Again, over here, because now we started talking about USB Type-C and having a super speed mux, the signal integrity definitely comes into question again. And normally the most important loss that happens is, main contribution factor for signal integrity degradation is basically having long PCB traces or some reflection on the connections or cables, and also insertion loss. This is also a very common factor for loss of data in longer traces. Over here, you see an example of a data flowing at different rates, flowing through a 36-inch trace. So here you can see that the eye diagram is very clean at 250 Mbits, but then at 2 gigs, you already start to see that the eye diagram is slowly closing. And at 4 gigs, there are a lot of bit errors. And at 6, I don't see where the eye is at all. I mean, I already don't see it at 4 gigs. So here you have no data that is being communicated. Let's take another example in terms of the length of the cable. Over here is an example of a 10 gig signal. If you pass the 10 gig signal at the length of 1 meter, you have a very clear eye diagram. Awesome, perfect. But then when you start increasing the length, the eye diagram starts to close again. And at 10 meters, there's almost absolutely nothing. So what do you do at this time? Excuse me. At such an instant, you could use a redriver or switch, which will help restore and attenuate the signal through equalization and gain adjustments. And then it retransmits the data that flows in And then it goes to the other side. Of course, this works bidirectionally. If you use a redriver along with the SuperSpeed MUX, it's called an active MUX. And we have quite a few devices that will help you, you know, pass this. And in the next version of the part of the webinar, Alex will also explain a little bit on how you can improve all of these capabilities. Now, the last topic is about having a full-fledged DP alternate mode. Over here, you have a power tree. So it's power tree and you have a host controller, which is taking care of the USB. But now you also have for the display or video source, a display port or video source. You can see until now, we were only talking about four channels, but now you are using all the eight channels of the transmit and receive signals. And over here, also please do notice, only a PD controller can be used. Let's move on. We talk about alternate mode a couple of times, but what exactly is alternate mode? So a few examples are DisplayPort, Thunderbolt, PCI, MHL, or HDMI. But apart from this, you could also have a custom alternate mode. And if you want to have an official alternate mode, you could get your mode approved by the USB interface and you will be given an SID. And over here with this, you can actually define how the entry and exit from this alternate mode will happen. And if you don't want an official alternate mode, you could also have a non-official alternate mode. And at this non-official alternate mode, you must own both the sites on the source and the sync to enable connection. In this nice block diagram, everything that's marked in yellow is required as a minimum or is required to support alternate modes. So these are the ports that you will actually use for alternate mode. Let's look at an example. As I said earlier, here we have a very nice example of a smart display. So I showed earlier the possible configurations through, you know, PD, right? So this smart monitor will be able to supply a laptop that it is connected to. And then in return, it takes the data to display from the laptop. So this is a standard example for USB PD at its best. So you can supply up to 20 watts. And over here, marked in blue, is the PD controller. As you can see, there are multiple functions that are supported by the PD. So instead of using different discrete solutions, you use one chip to handle all of these different functionalities. And as you can also see over here, you have one SuperSpeed MUX with or without redriver. And then this is again controlled by the PD controller. Let's look at this section over here. So we have a VBUS, and then you can see we have a back-to-back FET. So this is almost protected. But in this junction, because of such a small size of the USB port connector, if you connect it wrong or if there is debris or whatever, then there could be a short between D plus D minus or SPU to the VCON. In order to avoid that, it is highly recommended to use the ESD and overvoltage protection. And also for this special transmit and receive lanes, it's also advisable to have an ESD protection so that you protect the retimer at all times. Now, and another point that I would like to talk here on this voltage side is there are different power methodologies, right? But we recommend a simple flyback topology for the S power because it is simple and easy to control, and it's not as expensive as the remaining topologies. And over here, let me quickly summarize the hero parts for different standards. So if you want to use USB type A or BC 1.2, these are the parts that can target your application. And for USB type C, and this is for PD. But if you want to learn more and about USB Type-C, please visit us at www.tia.com/USB-C. Here you have different access to different training materials and also to a complete portfolio of redrivers and PD controllers. And as a summary, let me quickly just say one port for all for power, data, video, and audio. So we talked about various applications, mainly focusing on the personal electronic side, but this is not the case anymore. It's also going into various sectors of medical, personal health, or automotive, and so on. And if you have any questions and in detail, you could visit one of these resources, or you could also ask, or you could also reach out to us directly on e2e.ki.com, where our product experts will directly answer your questions. And in case of other questions, please feel free to shoot them in the Q&A. I have my colleague from the product line, and he can also answer the questions. Thank you. I'm going to stop sharing.
Let me start my presentation, because we're running out a little bit out of time. So, good day to you all. We heard a lot of things already. Let me try to give you a little bit more and not to overflow you completely. Start my presentation. Let's go. So, USB 3, I want to look from an EMI point of view, like discussed, and basically what we can create is a block diagram like this one, where we have one side we have the plug, and the other one side we have, of course, the IC in the application, and there are signals flowing from left to right in this case, and they all have some EMI considerations. So what we see here is that we have on the control line, we want to protect against ESD searches for the USB 2 and also for the USB 3. We want to protect for common mode noises, and also on the power line, we need some filtering, and every line needs its own ESD protection, basically. To make it a bit more visible, the Remco already showed this board, but it's a nice example how this could work. Is this picture where we can clearly identify the USB 3.2 signal lines. Let me give me a pointer, it would help you as well. The signal lines here in blue, and in the middle we see the backwards compatibility to USB 2.0. And of course, if you want to use the USB-C connector and you don't want to have USB 3.2 or whatever, then you can simply not use it and only use the USB 2 if that's what you need, and it could be handful if you only need the power delivery, but not so much the high speed data. Anyway, if we look a little bit more detail around layout, it's of course very important that you will have your impedance matching being done correctly, because if you have an impedance mismatch, like Nietzsche already indicated, then you will start seeing that decoration of your signal, which will close your eye diagram, and that if you have only a short distance to cover, that you might be able to do so. But if you especially have a somewhat more distance to cover, then that gets more and more critical, especially if you move to the high speeds of the USB standard, of course, then this will get very quickly very critical. So the PCB layout in itself is very, very important. And if, as you can see over here, we try not to make very sharp edges and try to be as straight as possible. And also, if the component selection you try to make is not too many bends, at least not if you can help it at any point. So this is what we see over here. From my point of view, the on the left side here, we have the combo chokes. Of course, we have different signal speeds. Also, we have to take different things in consideration. That means that we have to use different combo chokes. Same is true for TVS diodes. The signal speed is higher on the USB 3, so we have some different things to consider there. And on the bottom, you will see the EMI filter for the power line, which needs to be able to support up to 100 watts or less if you want to, of course, but if you want to have the full power range, then you need to support up to 100 watts to these components. So the current will be pretty high. You can see there 5 amps of current. And basically what we see here is an inductor in the middle, which is mainly taking care of the lower frequency band, 2 ferrites, on the left and on the right, which are mainly focusing on the higher frequency noises, and of course also a TVS diode to make sure there's no transients coming into the application that could destroy your IC. And the same can be said for the signal paths, of course. Not going into all the part numbers, you can find them by yourself. But what is important is that if you're going to look at your signal and you would just take any common mode choke from your drawer or whatever you can find it, and you put it in the signal path, that it could work, then you're lucky. But if you not take care good enough, then you probably will see that your signal will start to degrade very, very rapidly, because every common mode choke in itself has a very good common mode performance, of course, but that will be focused at a certain frequency range, and also there will be some differential modes behavior there, simply because there is a leakage inductance between the two windings, and that will act as a differential mode choke. So it's like being placing a normal choke in your signal path. That's something you probably don't want to do because your signal won't survive that. So if you're going to look for high speed data, then you really need to take care of that your influence of your signal is limited. Preferred zero, of course, but the higher you will go in frequency, at some point we will see that there will be some influence. And this graph will show you up to about 3 dB minus on insertion loss at really high frequency. So this is really a high frequency component. And same can be said for protection against ESD. Of course, you're going to need this because your IC will be sensitive to it, and the port will be external reachable. So someone in a test lab at some point will start shooting at it with an ESD gun. So you need to protect your circuitry. But if you place any TVS diode, the internal capacitance can be too high and your signal will degrade. And here you can see clearly two different ones. This one is meant for USB 2, which is lower frequency, of course. And the one on the right is really for USB 3.x, and clearly it has much less influence on the higher frequencies than the previous one. So these are very important things to consider. So looking a little bit more to common modes, when we have common mode noises, and this is a question I saw already popping up in the Q&A. They were saying, hey, why do I need a common mode choke? It's a differential mode pair. So wouldn't the currents of the signal cancel each other out? And yeah, that is true. If you would just look at the signal paths, the differential mode currents, those will be on the very close to each other, have the same current, so the magnetic field will also be the same, but the direction is opposite, so those fields will cancel each other out. That's one reason people love to use differential mode signal, because of that behavior. But every application can be either sensitive for external common mode noises that could interact with your system. It could be a cell phone, for instance, or whatever that is externally. But also internally, in a lot of cases, common mode currents will appear. Either they're being converted from differential mode currents into common mode currents, or they will have some other source. So they will always be there, and you have to fight them in order to make sure that your system starts working. So those common mode currents, those are always difficult to handle, because they will find a path and they will find some routes back to home, and some are okay, but often they also find a route back home which are caused by the capacitance coupling in the system, and those loops will start getting bigger and bigger, and then even small common mode currents can start radiated interference being too high, and that's why you probably want to add something like a common mode choke to the solutions. But again, we have to be careful which one we select. They have to be up to the job. So let's take a little bit closer look to common mode chokes. So we have for this kind of applications, we have CRV called CNSW, but you don't have to remember that one. What you do have to remember is that you have to look carefully at their performance. And in this graph, we compare two types with each other. We have a normal one for high frequency signals, usually 2.0 in that area. And we also have a high frequency one, which is more focused at higher frequencies. And in this graph, you see the solid line, which is the differential mode insertion loss. And you see the dotted lines, which are the common mode insertion loss. And of course, for your signal path, you can clearly see already that there's a big difference between the red and the black line over here. The black line is clearly better because the minus 3D point is over here. So it's close to 8 gigahertz, while for the normal version, it's close to 2 gigahertz. And you want, of course, when you have really high frequency signaling, you want to have this as high as possible. But because of the build of the component, and like we see over here, this is a ferrite core where we have windings wrapped around it. There will always be a capacitance coupling between them. There will always be leakage inductors there. So at some point, we will start seeing it starting to resonate, like we see here on the combo performance for the normal version. So when you optimize this, typically you also have less windings on the core. And this is why you see a less common mode performance for the high frequency versions. But you have to, because you have that high speed signal you want to preserve. You don't want to start filtering that away. Anish already talked a little bit about the eye diagram. I just popped in this slide very quickly just to for you those who don't know what an eye diagram is. Basically, what we do is we have a big overlay of all possible received bit sequences, and then we sum them up, and that will result in this very open eye. And if we're going to start to evaluate our signal, we want to maintain that open eye to make sure that your signal is still intact. And if it's not, then bit error rates will start to appear, and at some point your connection altogether won't even be there anymore. So just to make you a little quick comparison between a normal combo mode choke and a one for high frequencies, this is at 5 gigabits per second, written down here. And you can see there's already clearly a difference, but both eyes are still open and both will still pass. So in this case, we can use both of them. But it's clearly that the opening is already getting smaller and smaller over there. And also there's some difference in the jitter there, but we're not going into that details. But if we increase to 7 gigabits per second, then clearly we can already see that the normal CNSW is not up to the job anymore. The eye is getting too closed and the signal is really getting affected. Bit error rates will start to get higher and higher. And if you increase to the 10 gigabits, for instance, that we also have in USB, of course, then probably you won't even be able to set up your connection anymore. While the high frequency version is still be able to provide good combo mode filtering and maintain your signal. So there's an application note on our website if you want to know more about that. But there's also some different things going on, because it's not only about the USB, of course. It's not only about your HDMI or whatever high speed bus you're going to use. It could also be some DRAM on your system. That high data speed we're seeing is starting to affect other systems as well on your PCB, especially because a lot of applications, and this might be true for you as well, is getting smaller and smaller and smaller, and we want to back more functionality on that. So what we see in this example is that we have some wired connectivity, which is producing its EMI within reason, but it's close to a Wi-Fi antenna in this case, but it could also be Bluetooth or something else, which is running at 2.45 gigahertz. And this basically raises the noise floor and starting to detune your antenna. And this EMI of your signal is really starting to affect the working of your Wi-Fi. And what you can see over here is that this power band, if you measure this close to the USB-C board, you can see that the noise spectrum provided by USB 3.0, this even is, so this 5 gigabit, is already well beyond the 2.4 gigahertz band, which you would use for your Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. And well, of course, you will need some kind of minimum signal strength to be able to set up a connection. And if you want to really do some good things with that, you even need more signal strength. So this could be an an issue for modern applications. So in that regard, it's also good to realize what's next, because we're moving to 10 gigabits, 20 gigabits, 40 gigabits, and I can tell you now already, it won't stop at 40. At some point, someone will say, hey, we need 80 or whatever. So this will get more and more a problem in the future. So what did we think of within Wood Electronic? We have designed a completely new mode choke, which is not traditionally like the one we showed before with the ferrite core and winding structure. Now this one is really tuned for a specific frequency to optimize its common mode performance there, while still have very low differential mode impact. So this dotted line is the differential mode impact. So this is your signal, and the minus 3 dB point is around 12 gigahertz. So it's really high up in the spectrum. And at the 2.4 gigahertz, so where your Wi-Fi signals, where you really want to clean up your noise spectrum, this will provide you almost 50 decibels of insertion loss. So it's really powerful at that specific frequency. And we also, of course, have versions which can cover both the 2.4 and the 5.5 gigahertz, and some other versions are upcoming as well. So how does this work? Basically, it's a component with 6 pins. A normal combo, of course, has 4 pins, and we have an internal metal structure where we have the differential structure with this electromagnetical coupled to the reference potential, and the reference ground and the ground layer, and they are all connected electrically to the ground pins at the end. And inside this is really a fifth order filter, which is really tuned at a certain frequency. You know, the more orders you will add, of course, the more steeper that band will get, so we can really tune this as we want to. And this is something you cannot really do on the component side if you put it on the PCB, because of course there are L's and C's, but if you put this on the PCB, then of course you have to solder them, you have traces, and this will give all kinds of parasitics that would start influencing the filter. And this component is built from ceramic, so it's very comparable to chip antennas. In the construction way it is, at least. It's very accurate and very well controlled, and so we can really tune to those kind of frequencies. And looking at the comparison between the two, you can also see the big difference, of course. If you're used to the normal common mode chokes on the right with the ferrite core, which is the traditional one, those are tuned for wideband frequencies. But they are really reaching their limits because of the core materials, having the losses at some frequencies, of course, but also just because we wrap around windings, leakage inductance and capacitance between the coupling will limit the frequency span of those components. And on the left, the ceramic one is really, in this case, tuned to 2.45 gigahertz, is really focusing on additional core mode at specific frequencies where you might have some issues using high-speed data. And again, this could be anything, USB-C, but also HDMI memory buses. And if you translate it to the USB controller again, and then it could be very well that you have on your receiver side, you will have a traditional combo choke for filtering everything that's coming into the application and making sure that the noise that's coming from outside is not coming in. While the ceramic version is really on the transmitter side, making sure that you won't interrupt your own application or someone other's application that could be nearby. So this is a very quick summary of what I was planning to tell. I will skip this a little bit and move to the questions and answers, because I see we already passed our deadline a little bit. Then we'll stop sharing my screen like this. So let me see. Questions. We had some questions already in the site, and I see there are a lot more questions being added to the chat right now. But first, let me start with the first one I had recorded already. This one is for you, Remco. Not sure if you're here still.
I'm awake still, Alex.
Perfect. You provided the footprint, and the customer said, I don't see the paste on the THT pad. Why not?
I already saw it, so that's why I already make it possible to share. But can you make my presenter, then I can share my screen again?
Yeah, I will do change. Here you are.
Thank you. If I'm right now, you see in my screen.
Correct.
Yeah, you see here the paste printing or the stencil. And you see here really the dots here are really for the THR pins. So it's really still there for pasting. And at the bottom view, you also see here the rounds, and that's also for the pasta deposit for the THR pins. And then that's why he did that, that's the squares and that rounds are really particular for the make enough paste there, what I let you see also on the but you see that everything is filled on the right way, like you see here, and not on the other way here. So that's why I'm here still there. Yes, there are in the stencil design, there are placed now, must I say it, cavities for the THR pins. So that's still there. So
perfect.
So and then I stop sharing my screen, or you have some other questions?
Let me see. That's the same question. I think you can answer this one as well while you're still speaking. Customer is asking why we have foregrounds and two VCCs on the connector, I guess. I think that's a question you could answer as well. Can pass along to Niju as well.
I think it's more for Niju. I think, yeah.
Okay, then I will switch to Niju. Okay.
Yes, I will stop sharing.
Which question?
So the question here is, could you repeat why we have foregrounds and two VCCs? This was asked at the beginning of your presentation.
Ah, okay. Sorry, I missed this one. So we have four grounds and four power supply because we need to supply up to, let's say, 20 volts and up to 5 amp current. So in order to dissipate the heat, we need to have four different ports to support this. And did you say another port? I cannot find this question.
It could be sent to me privately. Sometimes I get them on via the wrong one. So I see a lot of questions already being answered in the Q&A.
Thanks, Eric.
Let me see if there's any open ones.
I see also one with 45 degrees of the routing of your PCB traces, I think.
Oh, right? Yeah, it's the bottom. Yeah. I was just going to it. So the question is here from the question is about routing, especially for high frequency signals. Of course, you don't want to have 90 degrees angles for sure, because the every time you make a bend in your microstrip, then of course you will change the width and length a little bit at that bend, and this could start being giving troubles because that will also change your appearance at that point. You're starting to reflect your signal a little bit, and it also initiates a nice e-field, providing you with a lot of more issues around EMI. And then, of course, you can create a little smaller angle. Well, the best, of course, is no angle at all. That is the best solution. 45 degrees typically should still be enough for this kind of applications, but the higher we'll go in frequency, the more critical that point will start to get. So that would be my take on that.
And I saw another question. What does I mean from Andrew? If I understood the question right, it is he wants to try to achieve USB 2 communication with the USB-C port. And he asks if he needs a power controller or the CC controller. During the presentation, I mentioned the USB port is a cold port, right? So in order to have added security, it is advisable to have the power switch on the top end. In case if you connect a legacy USB 2 connector, which is a hot switch, and then once the power transfer is starting, there could be reverse current flow from the USB-C connector to the older or the legacy connector, which would then probably cause damage. So in order to avoid it, a power switch is definitely recommended, and also the CC controller. If you want to also negotiate power, if this is not required, then you can skip this, and you can just connect it directly to some pull-up resistors. But I would definitely recommend to have a CC controller and a power switch, as mentioned in the diagram.
Just in general note for everyone, some people are asking for the presentation. We will send out an email in a few days, let's say up to a week from now, for where you can review the material on YouTube, and we can also share the presentation material with that same link as a yes. download.
Yeah, and if you have further questions, I see there were some coming up at the end. I'm sorry I did not answer them. You could as well write an email to needu@ti.com. So needhu@ti.com, and I will find the right person to answer this. I see if you, yeah, we can, or you can also reach out to e2e.ti.com.
There was another question for you, Remco, but I think yeah. we can handle that offline, maybe.
No, I see it here, but I can really explain it to it in a small way. Yes, I received another question about that paste for that THT parts, and then especially for the LTM footprint that we're supplying online. At that moment, you are right, Eric, you're right on that way, because there is still a choice for everybody that we can, that you will handle it on a sort of a THR or like wave soldering, because you can do both. And we see at this moment a lot of people are doing with selective wave, but if you do it on this way and you want more input on how to handle it with THR, please we get in contact on that way. I will send you a mail about that, how you can handle that. So, but yeah, you're right, at this moment the THR THT pins or THR pins are still not supplied with stencil layouts on that way, but that's coming up also.
And perfect. One last statement from my side, I had some slides that I did not show in the presentation, for example, like the CC and PD controller difference. I have a nice table. I could also add it to the presentation when I send it to you, Alex.
Perfect. Then we share that with all customers.
Yeah, that would really be nice.
So I think we have answered all questions. I was just browsing through them, and most of them already answered by Eric, I think, or by us just now.
And there was one question, if there is a standalone PD controller. Eric, I think we have a standalone PD controller, right? You don't need an extra host to do this.
Yes, we do have a standalone PD controller. We have a few options, whether you need alternate node support or not. But if you go to the ti.com/USB-C, we have a helpful portal there that can walk you through all the options we have.
Perfect.
Awesome. Thank you for the questions. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, that's same for me. I think we had a very, very nice session. Sorry that we were running a little bit late, and it was more content than time, but that's usually the case. So thank you for sticking with us. I think we have answered all questions. If you still have questions left from us, please reach out. We're always open to answer more questions. Let me share real quick my screen so that you can see our email addresses. And then we don't have this one. So from all questions regarding Root Electronic, you can use tech support at Benelux at W. Well, you can read it, or meet you at ti.com. This is the most easy way to reach out to us. And so please, all questions you have or we forgot to answer, please ring our bell We sent out an email with the video and also with a link to the presentation material. And then I really hope I can welcome you back in our next session, March 18th, about single pair Ethernet. I think it's also very interesting there. Well, thank you for your time. Hopefully see you next time. And goodbye.
Thanks, guys. Goodbye.
Thank you. Bye.